Friends, welcome to this very special session of Lit Fest, Pondicherry Lit Fest 2020. This year we are doing it online, and I thank the organizers of Lit Fest to make sure that this year we can continue with the wonderful program. I'm going to do a presentation on energy. And the title of my presentation is Towards a Sustainable Energy Future. Let us start the presentation. Of course, all of you are aware of the need of sustainable energy systems. And just as a quick reminder, we need those sustainable systems, energy systems, because we have a limited quantity of fossil fuels. We require energy security. And of course, the issue of global warming is very much alive. And of course, we know that conventional sources of energy create a great amount of pollution. Now, if you look at the world population and the way it has grown since 1950, I have a graph here only till 2010, but you can quite well imagine that this graph continues. We have grown from about 2.5 billion population in 1950s, and we have already crossed 7 today, 3 times. And if you look at the fossil fuel consumption in that same period, that has gone from 2,000 million tons of oil equivalent to more than 8,000 now. That's 4 times. Another interesting picture is to look at the world passenger car fleet. The passenger car fleet grew from 50 million and is now crossing 600 million. Now, the World Watch Institute in Washington, they published a couple of years ago already these 3 numbers. These 3 numbers show how many Earths we would need if everyone in the world would consume like currently, which already is 1.5 times, and I'm coming back to that in a minute. If we would all start living like people do in, say, Western Europe, we would need 3.4 planets, 3.4 Earths. And if we all would live as they do in the United States, we would need 5 Earths. And I checked again today morning, we have only 1. Now the first one, 1.5, how is it possible that we consume 1.5? It's simply because we are borrowing from the future. We are consuming today resources which the Earth cannot keep up with in terms of regeneration. That's how we already are overloading the planet today by 50%. The same story with CO2 concentration. Now you can see that it was pretty flat from 1642 till about 1850. But then when the commercial steam engine was launched, it went up almost like a vertical line. So we do have a very steep increase in the CO2 concentration worldwide. And that, of course, results in climate change, which is our main concern. Now, when people speak about energy, often the conversation goes straight away to renewable energy, which is definitely a very interesting subject. But I would like to first highlight 3 other steps that you take in parallel with going for renewable energy. The first step is that you try to define your needs. Now, that is a very subjective issue. I'm very much aware of it. But, you know, let me give you an example. Very often when you go to 5-star hotels or even 3-star hotels, the moment you enter the lobby, you feel actually cold. And very often the air conditioning is set at a temperature of 17, 18 or 19 degrees. Whereas if you come from outside with a temperature of say 39 or 40 degrees or even 36 or 37, you will be quite happy if you step into a place where the temperature is 25. So that is an example, not so much of need versus greed, but maybe an example of need versus absence of common sense even. So first define your need, and that is different for each person. That's quite subjective. The second step is, once you have defined your need, how can you manage that need with the least amount of artificial light, for example, in the case of lighting. You could, for example, open the windows, open the curtains. I mean, very often when you go to conferences and workshops, you sit in a room which is air conditioned at 90 degrees or 20 degrees with the curtains closed. So energy conservation is all about making sure that you use the natural resources which already are there, natural light, natural ventilation first. And then to the extent that you require artificial light and artificial cooling, then you come to the sphere of energy efficiency. And energy efficiency is about how do I get what is required with the minimum amount of energy. So it is separate from conservation. You do conservation, but you also do energy efficiency. And good examples of energy efficiency, of course, are how the LED lamp has replaced the incandescent lamp, and how certain cooling systems are now available which consume less than 40% of the conventional ones. And then we come to renewable energy, which is generating energy from sources that renew themselves. And then maybe for the time being, we still require to some extent fossil fuels. So I would recommend to all of you to always look at this pyramid, not to renewable energy alone, but also do the other steps of defining the need, conservation, efficiency. Now, to give you an example of how you can do energy saving, in this picture, you see on the left side, 100 units of conventional energy. Doesn't matter what those units stand for. They stand for kilowatt hours or metric tons. It is 100 units. And you see that these 100 units translate into a lamp giving light on the extreme right of the picture. And there are many steps in between. There is a transmission, there is distribution, there is the conversion, of course, of thermal energy into mechanical energy into electrical, and all that finally results in that lamp lighting up on the right side of the picture. Now just imagine if I would take that lamp out from the fitting and replace it not even with an LED, but just with a CFL, a compact fluorescent lamp. You see that 100 units of primary energy which entered the system on the left has now become 25 rather than 100. And if I would have put an LED lamp, that 25 would have been 10 or lower. So the message that these pictures try to give, we don't have much control over what happens on the left side of these pictures, but we do have a lot of control over what happens on the other side, on the right side, which is the demand side. And all of us can contribute in that regard. Now, solar energy is, of course, very much in the mainstream today. It has become cheaper than conventional energy in a cost per kilowatt hour. It addresses climate change and air pollution issues. The cost per solar watt has come down from 80 to now less than 20 rupees a watt. That should be 80 to 25 to 30. And then you have also the combination of rooftop solar and wind worldwide. And that mix of various renewable energy sources is the way to go forward. It is interesting that even financially, if a company, an industry, for example, would invest in solar, since in solar you have no recurring cost, you only have the upfront capital cost, your price per kilowatt hour stays the same for the whole period of, say, 25 years of the economic life, whereas conventional energy will increase in terms of cost, at least with the annual average inflation. So solar energy and wind energy are also used in the corporate world to hedge power cost. A very big issue, of course, in renewable energy is that it is not always available. The sun shines in the day, in the night there is no sunshine. Wind is, of course, day and night, but also seasonal. So what we need to have, in addition to renewable energy sources, we need to have storage. We have to be able to store the energy. And, you know, I want to give you one thought. I sometimes ask in workshops to the students and others that, can you tell me where the energy that is in coal, oil, and gas came from, or comes from, or came from, rather? And very often there is a searching for the reason, and it is, of course, a very simple answer. It's the energy in coal, oil, and gas originally came from the sun. So you can look at coal, oil, and gas as three huge batteries with solar energy stored into them. So actually the whole energy paradigm that has to change is that we change those three batteries, coal, oil, and gas, with sustainable batteries. The source stays the same. The source has been and will be the sun. Mind you, even a major part of wind energy is caused by temperature differences. So the sun is your source. What has to change is the storage. Storage prices have come down, as this graph shows. And that brings us then to the possibility of distributed generation. And I'm happy to share a few pictures with you of what we have done in Auroville. Auroville is in Tamil Nadu, close to Pondicherry. And we have already, since many years, installed solar systems on roofs and also on the ground as part of a distributed generation program. And in distributed generation, what you do is that you distribute the sources of energy, as is the case with consumption. This picture shows you the conventional grid. The conventional grid is a one-way grid. Energy flows from central power plants towards millions of consumers. Whereas the grid of the future is a grid which is multidirectional. Energy flows also from consumers back to the grid. Energy flows from consumer to consumer. Energy flows from multiple generation sources, including solar, wind, biomass, etc. So the grid of the future makes use of most of the existing grid infrastructure. Fortunately, those wires are quite flexible. They don't mind whether the electrons flow from left to right or right to left, with some modifications maybe in the protection switchgear. But that grid of the future will look more like this. So the centralized and decentralized discussion, which always happens in many workshops, there's always this centralized versus decentralized discussion. I would like to rename this as centralized becomes distributed, but distributed and still connected. And why connected? So that the surplus of a cluster or of a building or of a town or even of a country can flow to areas where there is an instantaneous deficit. So instead of generating in one place or in a few places in huge power plants, one will generate renewable energy in thousands of locations, many locations. But those locations are all interconnected, so that the energy can flow where it is needed and that systems support each other. If you combine that distributed generation with distributed storage, then you make a lot of progress towards a sustainable energy future. This is a picture of one of those roofs in Auroville where there is solar energy. We have another picture here. This is an aerial view. This is part of a project which we have named as the Smart Mini Grid. And the Smart Mini Grid project will basically includes distributed solar energy generation and distributed storage. And what we already see happening is that since this cluster of buildings is connected to the other parts of Auroville through our internal network, every day between about 10:30 and 4 in the day, surplus solar energy travels out of this cluster and serves other clusters in Auroville. This is a picture of the inverters and other equipment of the smart mini grid. This, of course, is a picture of a rooftop solar system whereby the energy is self-consumed by the building with the surplus going to the grid. And different states in India have different policies. Many of them have net metering, some have net feed-in. But the basic idea is that the rooftop solar will generate power on the house, on top of the house, or next to the house if you have a garden. You self-consume and you export the surplus. Now, what is the big advantage of this is that there is zero transmission and zero distribution losses, because the energy is generated exactly where it is consumed. And even the surplus which leaves the building will not travel a long distance. It will simply go to the neighboring house. The nearest load which is available and which needs power will be served by that surplus energy. So distributed solar energy generation has also the advantage of eliminating transmission losses 100% and reducing distribution losses to a very low percentage. To conclude this presentation, I want to just highlight a few policies and schemes that are presently running in the country. We do have a lot of supportive policies and with very clear targets. The target for solar, for example, is 60 gigawatt, that is 60,000 megawatt for utility scale, that is the bigger scale, and 40,000 megawatt to be achieved for the consumer category, mainly rooftop, by 2022. There are government subsidies available for certain consumer categories. For example, for domestic consumers, there is a subsidy available for a certain size of solar plant, which they install on their roof. Then there is the KUSUM scheme, solar systems for the agricultural sector. I'm happy to tell you that Auroville has been involved in implementing this scheme. We have drafted various technical and financial documents that enable the implementation. In fact, we have also been active since 2012 in supporting governments, state governments, with the drafting of solar energy policies. And now we are busy with the KUSUM scheme, mainly KUSUM C. KUSUM C is where an existing agricultural connection is provided with a solar system, so that grid power gets replaced with solar power. And again, the surplus getting pumped into the grid. What is very interesting is that the International Solar Alliance has its headquarters in India. And that has given the whole solar programs in India itself a very big boost. And then there is another example of an initiative. There's a much longer list than this, but I'm just highlighting a few, that Solar Energy Corporation of India was established, SECI, which facilitates numerous schemes. For example, SECI is instrumental in putting solar energy on government buildings. It sometimes will act as a RESCO. RESCO stands for Renewable Energy Service Corporation or Company, where it basically provides the renewable energy to the building and takes care of the capital cost. Look up on the internet all about SECI. SECI is a very interesting organization in India. So these are just a few examples. To conclude, what I would like to highlight is that the future, a sustainable energy future, will include a high amount of distributed generation, distributed storage, all interconnected. And basically, a smart grid is a grid where this is done smartly. The interconnection is done smartly. The interconnection may even include some remote demand side management. That means, for example, that instead of doing load shedding in case of an emergency, load shedding meaning switching off the power, you remotely reduce the load instead of switching off the load. So smart grids include all those components: distributed and connected renewable energy systems with storage is one important component for a sustainable energy future. Thank you very much.